by NuMark Credit Union. Today we're going to be talking with the IT guy. Yeah, the IT guy. Kevin Quinn will join us in a moment. Couple of things I need to tell you first. At the end of the program, we're going to be giving away a $25 Visa gift card, compliments of NuMark Credit Union. Just listen between now and the bottom of the hour, and then I'm going to ask a question. That question will come from some information that Kevin and I discuss here in a matter of just a couple of moments. I'll ask you to repeat that information, and then if you're the first person to do it, you're going to get $25 to spend at NuMark Credit Union or anywhere else, anywhere you want. It's a Visa gift card. Just go. Spend it. Knock your socks off. Go get some lunch. Go buy me a present. Do whatever you want with it. And you can do more with your money with an auto loan from NuMark Credit Union. They're ready to talk about how you can get your dream vehicle or save on your current one. Rates as low as 1.49 APR. Learn more and apply by calling NuMark today at 815-729-3211 or visit NuMarkCU.org. That's NuMarkCU.org, NuMark Credit Union, where you are family. Ladies and gentlemen, Kevin Quinn. Kevin, when you're called the IT guy, is that a compliment in your world, or is it just like, oh my God, they think I'm an IT guy? Well, you are an IT guy. Is that a compliment or not?
I guess it depends on the expectations of the title. I kind of do, because of, you know, the size of the credit union, I do get my hands in everything. So I definitely wear a lot of hats here. But when IT guy entails that, you know, my grandparents think that I know the latest in home printer technologies, then it could be a little cumbersome because there's some expectations that come with it. You know, you get with you know, being involved in a financial institution, more involved in the enterprise side of things. So consumer technology ends up getting, you know, lost with everything else. But yeah, I mean, no, it's definitely definitely a good title and an all-encompassing title.
All right. You know, you probably don't like, hey, where's the printer paper, IT guy? You don't like that, do you?
No. Printer paper, surge protector, extension cord. Yeah, that could be a little bit beyond the scope of, you know, my job description. I'm happy to do it, but I've been asked to do all sorts of things. I've even had to free a mouse from a mouse trap at our Joliet office before, so it's a little bit of everything.
Nice. There you go. Well, that's why people like you. That's why they respect you, because you're willing to go above and beyond most IT guys. That is for sure. So in all seriousness, Kevin is here, and his job is to keep your information safe, the bank's information safe, your money safe. So it is a big job, and they have a good man for the job. Kevin's been doing this for a long, long time. And here we are. We're, you know, post-pandemic, and we're back to normal, and people are scamming people like never before. And oh, my word. So what do you think the lasting changes will be about post-pandemic in terms of technology? What happened because, and then what will last, and maybe what won't?
Yeah, exactly. It's, you know, it's funny because if you look this up, you know, there's been countless articles written on, you know, the lasting changes post-pandemic. And some people trying to guess on that as early as June 2020, probably a little more off than, you know, what we're seeing come about more recently, the projections from that. So hopefully this, you know, this conversation is coming completely 100%, you know, post-pandemic, and, you know, we're now, you know, educated based on what we've learned from it. But I think as everybody can kind of see, digital self-service solutions are definitely, they're omnipotent now. Like, they're everywhere, and they're here to stay. It's going to be a major driver even for small businesses, the ability to do business online. It had been a thing in the past. It had been very important in the past. But now it's absolutely critical, and we're seeing that, you know, a lot of businesses may have gone under because of the inability to offer their services online without needing, you know, a physical type interaction. I think a lot of people are also seeing the proliferation now of, you know, video conferencing and, you know, any kind of digital conferencing, Microsoft Teams, Zoom, GoToMeeting, pretty much, you know, the list, it's an endless list at this point. But it just kind of has not replaced, because I don't think anything will replace face-to-face meetings, but it has definitely been something where it's more common now. And then if people can get together, they will get together, but video conferencing has been a big thing. And, you know, with that remote work, it's very, hard to guess what the, you know, the future 2-3 to, you know, 10 years down the line will be with remote work. But I think it's here to stay, at least in a much larger capacity than it was before. You know, it was just a few people here and there you'd meet who would work remotely from their jobs, and it was kind of a cool thing, and you'd ask them how they do it. But it's a lot more common now, and it's a lot more sought after. You know, a lot of people in this job market, especially being, you know, a market very friendly to the job seeker, not so much, you know, the employer recruiting, but, you know, job seekers out there looking at the job descriptions, looking at the requirements and seeing that, you know, this is remote, or, you know, this requires me to be in the office every day, and then kind of making a conscientious decision based on that.
Sure.
But I think a lot of businesses have to be prepared for it, be prepared for that expectation. And you might not realize it at first, but it can be a hindrance to not offer that if it's possible, obviously. But it definitely helps you stay competitive. And another big thing that, you know, I think everybody is kind of getting into is a lot of AI and automation, and, you know, a lot of people were flooded in different areas of their businesses where they just couldn't hire staff to keep up. And I know for a lot of people, it was, you know, call centers and, any kind of digital communication. So what we're seeing a lot of is the real growth in, chatbot delivered, communication, and really AI being built into those chatbots. I think everybody has, you know, a whole spectrum of experiences when it comes to interacting with a chat system online, especially when you know that on the other end of that is a computer and not a real person.
Right.
I know a lot of people, yeah, and myself included, just press zero, you know, until their finger falls off, or just start screaming operator. There is a benefit to it when somebody that if you can make that experience positive, and you know kind of the gamut of what your customers are there asking about, and you can have a system that can intelligently answer those and deliver a positive experience, yeah, you can make both ends happy. You know, it lessens the reliance on actual physical agents to answer those calls, and then the customer is able to get their question answered in a timely fashion, seconds rather than minutes.
Exactly. Let me jump in here real quick, Kevin. Let's kind of go back to people working from home. Still, it's great, and a lot of people are doing it, but what do you have to look out for? Because employees and employers, what should they consider in a new work from home environment? And I guess I'm talking security, because there's a lot of valuable information that people aren't using firewalls for at home. So I think it's important to point out to employers right now, if you have people working from home, depending on what kind of job it is, you need to install some hardcore firewalls, don't you?
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. I think first and foremost, the most important thing for, I think it benefits employers and employees, but the most important thing, you got to put a policy around it. I think for an employer, it cements what your expectations are for the work from home role, as far as security concerns and, you know, how that person will access the network, expectations around physical records. You know, will that person be allowed to print things? Will they be able to bring, you know, work home, print stuff in the office and bring it home? What are the expectations around that? And I mean, the benefit to the employee is they have a clear set of boundaries that, you know, it makes it obvious what you can and can't do.
Right.
So they don't have, you know, not going to a supervisor to ask, well, can I do this? Can I do this? Having that policy really meant, you know, what the expectations are. And for employers, it's a ton. I mean, if you don't have the means to purchase security technology, can be very expensive. I mean, I'm in the game. I know how it goes. There are some basic things that you could do that are much less expensive than some of these $100,000 million, you know, remote access system investments.
Right.
And there are a lot of companies that you can work with. A lot of these local managed service providers, a lot, you know, companies that you might just be purchasing keyboards and PCs and everything else from, a lot of them will offer free assessments as far as like your security when it comes from a work from home perspective. You really want to have the weight of that on the employer's technology so that whatever's going on at the employee's home, you know that at least connection to your business is secure, and at least, you know, the path for all that data is being cured. And really the only thing that you're fighting with is maybe bandwidth, contention. Somebody's at home and their kid's playing, a game online or something, and then they're having issues answering phone calls because there's, you know, glitches in the voice conversation.
Sure.
But you really want to kind of take a lot of that on yourself and, you know, also formalize it in a policy and just let the employee know what the expectations are around everything.
All right, let's get into security. By the way, we're talking to the IT guy, Kevin Quinn from NuMark Credit Union, Chief Information Officer. So actually, he's a CIO, not just an IT guy. So Russia, Ukraine, cybersecurity, does this mean anything for us?
Oh, yeah, I mean, this list could go on for days as far as, you know, what's come out of it. You know, with the obvious, like, more kind of, I guess, really upsetting issues going on with loss of human life and everything else, you know, there is a cybersecurity warfare piece going on right alongside of it. And a lot of that, you know, is going back and forth between Russia and Ukraine. But there are still a lot of things that are, you know, affecting everybody, even outside of those areas. A lot of these campaigns are really kind of hitting businesses, hitting any area, you know, hitting places where accounts might be held for Russian oligarchs and everything else. There's vigilante attacks going on. You know, Anonymous from 4chan has gotten a lot involved in a lot of vigilante attacks against like the Russian state and the church and all the different oligarchs and all of that. There's cyber espionages. Cyber espionage campaigns going on against Ukraine that new ones have detected as recently as yesterday. Whatever threat actors attacking China for support of Russia, and then bot farms out there. And really, this is the one, I mean, it affects you from a more, what you see on the internet, what you're consuming on the internet. But Ukraine recently just actually took down a series of 5 bot farms with over 100,000 fake social media accounts that were spreading disinformation.
Wow.
About everything going on in Russia and the Ukraine. So that's 100,000 personalities out there spreading completely wrong information and, you know, injecting themselves in threads on Twitter, injecting themselves in, you know, on Facebook and different types of social media platforms. So it's pretty wild what's going on out there. And, the actual physical violence and everything, that is what belongs on the news. No doubt about it, there is a cyber, war going on behind the scenes.
Yeah, you got it. All right. Kev, let's talk for a minute here real quick about we could go on about this for an hour, but when people hear the expression dark web, what is the dark web?
It's really, to make it as succinct as possible, because I know I can ramble, but it's basically... It's a web technology where, you know, the websites therein are only accessible through a specific browser, the Tor browser. And it's not governed by, you know, with a traditional website, google.com, facebook.com, wherever you go to, there are regulations around hosting that. You know, you're responsible to a registrar that you've registered that domain name with. there's obligations to it. There's oversights and regulations. The dark web has none of that. If you have this browser, you can set up a site on the dark web, and there's nobody to take you down unless, you know, the local authorities of your country come in and seize your assets.
Right.
So you pair a VPN connection with a Tor browser, and it becomes a relatively anonymous place. There's so many negative connotations with the dark web, rightfully so. There's a lot of criminal activity that happens there. But in respects to what's going on in Russia and Ukraine, there's actually a lot of positive that's going on there, because that level of anonymity is helping whistleblowers, it's helping protesters, it's helping people that are trying to get the word out about what's actually happening. And alongside that, social media companies like Twitter have actually made their site accessible on the dark web. There's a dark web presence for Twitter right now because of Russian social media bans. So it's a useful technology. It stays kind of dark just because of, you know, what else happens on there. But right now there is some really positive uses being made of it to kind of help people get the word out and help people communicate and help people stay in touch during some kind of troubling times in Russia and Ukraine.
What about data breaches? Haven't heard too many. You know, we've heard Target at one point. We heard, I think it was Chase. Are we doing better in the world of data breaches?
We are not. So this is the way that everybody got COVID fatigue, or, you know, at some point, I think we've hit data breach fatigue, where it's just not, it's not sexy enough to make the news anymore. These are going on every day, though. There's companies like Okta, Microsoft Azure DevOps, Robinhood, Twitch, Neiman Marcus, T-Mobile.
Oh, boy.
The list goes on and on and on. It's really, and I mean, rising, but always staying at the top is, you know, these issues continue to be financially motivated and done by typically organized crime, which is not, you know, your traditional Al Capone and the mafia, but some of these organized, you know, ransomware for hire groups that are typically selling their stuff on the dark web. But the biggest part of this is going to be, or the biggest driver of this is typically done through social engineering, which is your phishing attacks, that's your, you know, phone calls and scams and issues like that. So it's continuing to go on. It's growing. It's getting bigger and bigger. It's just, I think we've hit the limit of where
we don't pay attention to it. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It's just, it's fallen to the background. And especially with everything that's going on with COVID and with the issue in Russia and everything else, it's just, they're jumping on the opportunities, and it's grown bigger and bigger over time.
All right. Give us some scams here, buddy. It's something that we should be looking for here at a local level.
Yeah. I mean, some of the big ones still going on. I mean, it seems like the most successful ones just continue to churn and take victim after victim. But we're still seeing a lot of, you know, the romance scams, where typically the elderly fall for a scam involving somebody saying that they want to be their girlfriend, and they're living in, you know, let's say Ireland right now, when really they're not anywhere near there. But they need some money because they want to come see them, and just pretty much any trick in the book to kind of extort that person out of money. And a lot of people, you know, just will keep going along with it. And then once it happens that they find out it's fake, or they don't want to believe it's fake, but sometimes when they find out it's fake, they're too embarrassed to tell anybody, and they just take a huge loss on it. Another big one right now is government imposters, people pretending to be from the government and basically telling you that, you know, you could go to jail, or your social security could be at risk. And giving kind of these weird ways to deliver the payload to them of, you know, we need $20,000, $30,000, $40,000, and it needs to come through Bitcoin, or it needs to come through gift cards, or just really non-traditional methods of payment. I mean, obviously, because, you know, there's less tracking in those types of systems for the threat actor. But if you see that, that has to ring some bells, and it really, I you got to be skeptical when you hear anything about that. And just stay on with the tech support scams, fake antivirus scams, and unemployment benefit scams, which have been going on for as long as I remember and just continue to go on. And obviously, that has to speak to some of the success that they have.
In other words, Kevin, guys like you are always going to have a job.
Stay busy out here. The world seems to only get crazier. I've found that. I've always waited for it to slow down just a little bit, but that's not the way it goes. It just accelerates.
It does. Absolutely, it does. Kevin, as always, great job. We appreciate it. And I guess in 30 seconds here, just let people know how much you guys put into keeping people's identity, all their information safe at NuMark.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's one of the biggest things for my department and my staff and any security staff we have involved is staying on top of exactly what's going on out there. If you don't know the way that the threat landscape is evolving, how can you protect against it? So we're always looking at new types of security, new things that we can layer on top. Security is like an onion. And one layer is never significant because there's always holes in that one layer, and you just have to keep layering on top to get some kind of approach that balances security, but also, you know, kind of lets the user do their job at the end of it. You know, the ultimate security would just be turning all the computers off, but I don't think that's the most efficient. No. So yeah, so it's a way of layering security and, finding ways to, you know, make the usability there too for the employee. So we're just always staying informed, always staying on top of what's going on and trying to take a proactive approach wherever and whenever possible.
You got it. Kev, as always, buddy, it's so interesting. I just sit here and soak it all in and try to absorb as much as possible because so much information. But thanks for coming on, and we'll talk to you again real soon, okay?
Absolutely. Thanks so much, Scott.
All right, brother. Be good. That's Kevin Quinn, the IT guy, chief information officer with NuMark Credit Union. All right. Right now, ladies and gentlemen, I have a $25 gift card courtesy of NuMark to give away. Simple question. Are we seeing more data breaches or less? What is going on in the world of data breaches? Are they becoming more or less common? 815-254-7300. That is the phone number. First correct caller on the Turk Furniture Studio Line wins. Hi, good morning. You're on WJOL. Who is this?
Hi, Scott. It's Rita.
Hello, Rita. More or less data breaches?
More.
You dang right. You are dang right. Rita, congratulations.